Everybody, welcome to the Ventura Center for Spiritual Living. We are so blessed, and we are blessed to have Reverend Jennifer here to offer us some announcements.
Yes.
Bless her.
Hello.
Hello. We are so blessed to have Kenny in the house. So good morning. Welcome to Ventura Center for Spiritual Living. I'm going to run through our announcements pretty quick. And if you have any questions, everything is on our website at www.venturacsl.org. So it's on there. And if you're here in service, you can find out about things at our concierge desk, which is after service, we have hospitality, and the concierge desk is on that side. So go ask somebody over there. They'll be able to answer any of your questions. Really quick, today we have a beautiful flower arrangement. It was not donated anonymously, but it's lovely, so I just wanted to acknowledge I like flowers. Anyway, so let's see what else we got going on today. We have Gourmets for God bidding. The bidding will last until April 28th. So we have 20 parties back there to bid on. If you haven't already registered to bid, please register with me or Jen Seal Luce. I'll get it eventually. They've only been married for I don't know how many years. see one of us, and we'll get you registered and get you a booklet. Today, after service at noon, we have the Self-Hypnosis for Success workshop with wonderful Shelley Ehler. She's over there in the green jacket. So that starts at noon, and you can still sign up. You can sign up online through the website, or you can sign up here in person and pay. That's a $50 workshop. It's noon to 1, and it'll be in here in the sanctuary. Starting tomorrow, Reverend Susan Burrell is going to start her energy and action class in person, and then it's on Zoom on Tuesdays. It's for 6 weeks. This class, you will learn about the 13 universal laws and corresponding rays of light that assist in transforming stuck energy and emotions so that you can manifest the life you want. So if you have questions about that, Reverend Susan will be in the social hall after service, and she can answer your questions. We also have the book that's in that for that class in the bookstore, so you can check that out. Also in the bookstore is this month's book, The Soul of the Octopus. We have a couple copies of that, so check out the bookstore after service, too. This coming Wednesday is the third Wednesday. It's going to be the Science and Spirituality Discussion Group. It starts at 6:30. We'll go to 8. It's going to be with Pete and Mari. Wave, Pete. If you have any questions, say Pete. And I don't know where Mari is. Mari's somewhere. There's Mari. Mari's back there. And they'll tell you they're going to be discussing the book The Divine Matrix by Greg Braden. But if you haven't read the book, still come, because you'll learn all sorts of things, and it'll be a great discussion. Let's see. Volunteers, where is Bernie? Bernie, stand up. Woo! There's Bernie. Bernie is our board member that is in charge of volunteer coordinating. So if you are interested in volunteering, especially if you would like to volunteer in Prasad, with Circle of Blessings, or even with the tech team, please talk to Bernie. She will find where you will fit perfectly, and we'll get you more integrated into the community. So thank you, Bernie. Choir rehearsal today. Our Hearts and Harmony Choir rehearses on Sundays. They will be downstairs from 11:30 to 12:30, right? Yes. Other options, like I said, we have hospitality back there, we have the bookstore, and then we have after service, we have 1 minute miracles, so you can pray with a practitioner down here. So after service, you'll see everybody coming down here to pray with you. If you have something to celebrate or something you need to work through, pray with a practitioner. And if you are watching at home, please remember to share. And if you rewatch this on YouTube or you watch on YouTube, please make sure you follow us on YouTube or subscribe or whatever it is on YouTube. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Jennifer. Appreciate it, Rev. Thanks. If you're just coming in, welcome. You're at the Ventura Center for Spiritual Living. I think you knew that, though. And so here we are. And I'm inviting Jessica. Where's she at? There she is, Jessica, to come forward. And would the kiddos like to come on down, too? Yeah. Jessica is with our Youth and Family Department, and she is going to enlighten us. Hey, you're okay. Either way.
Okay, yeah. Stand.
Okay. Yeah. Either way.
Good morning. Hi, guys.
Hi, everybody. Good to see you. Hi. Hi.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. I'm Jessica Lunetta with VCSL Youth and Families. I'm going to briefly, it's a one page, talk about awe and this last week's total solar eclipse. Some of my family went on vacation this past spring break to the middle of nowhere, Midwestern United States. We did this to visit family friends, you know, friends that are like family, but also see the total solar eclipse. My kids grew up on books such as Contact and Cosmos by Carl Sagan. Any astronomical event is a huge deal to our family, whether it's watching from our own backyard as Elon Musk launches one of his mini rockets from Vandenberg Air Force Base on a Tuesday at 2:30 because he can, or traveling to see an incredible opportunity like the eclipse. It's a real bonding experience. Millions of people collectively experienced awe by watching this year's total solar eclipse. You can catch the next one here in the US in 2044. You'd be hard-pressed to find a more powerful way to feel small than looking up at the skies and witnessing an object that is 2 million times your own size, the moon, completely block your view of an object that is 800 billion times your own size, the sun, and 93 million miles away. It's kind of a big deal to feel this small. A solar eclipse is an extraordinary spectacle that often leaves us speechless as we experience an event that does not fit with our daily understanding of the world. In the middle of the afternoon, the sun disappears, the temperature drops, and the Earth's creatures are confused by what appears to be nightfall. The self-transcendent emotions that we may feel are incredibly important for promoting a better world. These moments of awe and wonder can be powerful ways to help people feel small in the presence of something great. A solar eclipse is an opportunity for millions of people to share in a collective moment. It moves powerfully across individual beliefs and transcends religious, class, race, gender, and political lines. There is a collective kindness that comes in sharing the experience together when witnessing a vast and stellar event, such as an eclipse. Awe also involves the needing for accommodation, the adjustment of our cognitive structures in order to absorb new experiences of wonder, which is why awe can also be linked with feelings of confusion, disorientation, and even fear. Sometimes we are not able to make sense of our confusing and frightening encounter with a larger-than-life object of awe. But other times we succeed in accommodating this new experience, and when we do, fear and confusion might be replaced by feelings of enlightenment and understanding. These moments are when we grow. There is value in big emotions, especially awe, for our well-being. So embrace little and big moments of awe, wonder, the awesome, the wonderful, and you may find yourself enlightened. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. We'll see you later. All right. Prayers for youth and family? Okay. All righty. Okay, so let's turn within and listen to Vicky's prayer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ministers, reverends, practitioners standing here with me and our beloved family at VCSL. Know with me right here, right now, that all is spirit, all is love, all is the blessing of each breath. And I know that this love flows through me and with me. And I give great thanks for today, and a special thanks for the face of God that is seen through those that serve with such love and such humility and joy, those with the whiskers and the tails and the fur and the scales and the wings and the tentacles. Those beautiful, beautiful animals and insects all around us in this lovely spring, I give great thanks. And I know that today shows us how to be present and filled with love like these light beings that I speak of. I know the music and the poetry and all that is today serves to show us the light that is within us and is us, that can light up this entire world and show peace and love to all. And so humbly I surrender to this and know the joy and the beauty of being here today. With great thanks, I simply release my prayer into God's love, and together we say, and so it is.
So it is. Thank you, Vicky. So let us continue to breathe deeply, breathing in, breathing out, allowing ourselves to be still and know the divine presence that brought us here today by divine appointment. As we breathe, we rest, we relax, we let go, and we open our hearts to listen to the words of our sacred reading.
An excerpt from The Soul of an Octopus by Cy Montgomery. On a rare warm day in mid-March, when the snow was melting into mud in New Hampshire, I traveled to Boston, where everyone was strolling along the harbor or sitting on benches licking ice cream cones. But I quit the blessed sunlight for the moist, dim sanctuary of the New England Aquarium. I had a date with a Pacific octopus. I knew little about octopuses, not even that the scientifically plural is not octopi, as I had always believed. But what I did know intrigued me. Here is an animal with venom like a snake, a beak like a parrot, and ink like an old-fashioned pen. It can weigh as much as a man and stretch as long as a car. It can pour its baggy, boneless body through an opening the size of an orange. It can change color and shape. It can taste with its skin. Most fascinating of all, I had read that octopuses are very smart. How could that be? It's hard to find an animal more unlike a human than an octopus. Their bodies aren't organized like ours. We go head, body, limbs. They go body, head, limbs. Their mouths are in their armpits. Or if you prefer to liken their arms to our lower instead of upper extremities, their mouths are between their legs. They breathe water. Their appendages are covered with dexterous, grasping suckers, a structure for which no mammal has an equivalent. Octopuses represent the great mystery of the other. They seem completely alien, and yet their world, the ocean, comprises far more of the earth than does land. Most animals on this planet live in the ocean, and most of them are invertebrates. I wanted to meet an octopus. I wanted to touch an alternate reality. I wanted to explore a different kind of consciousness. I wondered, what is it like to be an octopus? Isn't this what we all want to know about those whom we care about? What is it like, we wonder, at each meeting, in shared meals and secrets and silences? With each touch and glance, we wonder, what is it like to be you? And so it is.
And so it is. And so, breathing deeply again, just in that wondering, what is it like to be you? What is it like to be divine? What is it like to be human? What is it like to be an octopus? Let us embrace the mystery of the I Am Presence as it lives and moves and has its being through all of us. Together we sing, I Am Remembering Who I Am, and we remember for ourselves that we are that infinite presence that embodies all. And we also remember for the entire cosmos that the I Am is everything, and everything is the I Am. Let us sing together, I Am Remembering Who I Am.
Oh,
Living in the presence as the presence. Let us breathe in deeply, then gently open our eyes as love and in love and in service to what is as it is and so it is. Namaste.
Well, good morning. How is everyone? You look great. You look great. You know, my head is so full already just because of Hugh's reading, which I always love. I so look forward to those every time I come. I got up this morning feeling grateful for a change. Feeling grateful, honestly. That's been a bit of a challenge for me. I don't know about you, but for any number of reasons. And something happened to me yesterday, so simple and so silly. I was at Trader Joe's and buying some produce, and I went over and I was grabbing some tomatoes and went and grabbed a carton, moved one carton, grabbed another, and put the one into my basket and heard something slide and hit the floor. And I turned around and there were like 40 little cherry tomatoes all over the floor. And what shocked me was immediately there was this lovely couple who were not together, a man and a woman, but they immediately got down and started grabbing all of these tomatoes to help me put them back into the basket. And in recent years, I have just felt like so many people, so much separation. Everybody with their own agenda, not so much care, concern, compassion, respect. And I know that is something that is a big focus of mine. Peace. Joy, love, compassion. And these are things that I always hope that I am giving and sharing with others. But we very often forget these are gifts that we need to bestow upon ourselves. And Jennifer Russell writes a beautiful song that we're going to do for you right now. That reminds me of what's really so important to share with one another and with ourselves. Come on, Chris. The gifts I choose for you are peace, joy, and understanding. The gifts I choose for the earth are laughter and harmony. And with my heart I wrap these gifts with love. With love. And with my hands I tie a ribbon of compassion. The gifts I choose for you are peace, joy, and understanding. The gifts I choose for the world are friendship, sweet friendship. And peace.
ribbon of compassion, compassion. Oh, the gifts I choose for you are peace, joy, and understanding. The gifts I choose for the world are friendship, sweet friendship, and peace.
Thank you, Dion and Chris. Beautiful job. Thank you so much, as always. It's great to see you all here today. Thank you. Where do I begin? I know, lead by inner transformation. That's what it says on my slide. Okay, so in this spiritual center, I think we do things a little differently than a lot of the world. A lot of the world is about changing things out here, about rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic and calling it change. However, we are called to lead by inner transformation. And the way we've been framing inner transformation lately has been in this principle that we're calling heartivism, which is the sacred or mystical application of activism. And the components of heartivism are goodwill, intentions of goodwill, small acts of kindness, and then non-attachment, trusting that our small acts of kindness will ripple because ripples are real. The small acts of kindness that we do, we may never see the results of them, but we trust that the ripples have an impact in the future of somebody else's lives. Okay. This morning I have a question for you. Would you like to grow in your ability to ease suffering? Whether it's, yeah, say yes, please. Okay, thank you. I saw some people like, maybe, I don't know. Yeah. It's our own personal suffering, but it's also the suffering of the world. So if you'd like to grow in your ability to ease suffering, you've come to the right place. But first, I want to talk about octopuses. The name of this talk is, What Is It Like to Be You? And in the reading that Hugh did such a beautiful job with, the author asked, what would it be like to touch an alternative reality? What is it like to be an octopus? What is it like to be you? Now, for a minute, talking about octopuses, they are not what I thought they were. Octopuses, as you may know, if you've read books about, like, science fiction books or whatever, they're often portrayed as evil beasts that are liable to lop the head off of a sailor at the drop of a hat, right? They're also portrayed sometimes as just invertebrate blobs that lie on the bottom of the ocean. But have any of you seen the movie My Octopus Teacher, right? Beautiful movie. Oh, yes, hallelujah. That was an enthusiastic yes. Yeah, we just watched it again last night, and we both cried a lot. Like, not even when, spoiler alert, you know, when something happens to the octopus, but just the relationship that the octopus and the man had together, right? It's just amazing. And that movie and this book says so much about what it is like to be an octopus, what it is like to be this animal that we take for granted. That octopuses are curious, that they seem to have a sense of humor, that they are playful and they're mischievous and they have intelligence and they dream, right? They dream like, have you ever seen your cats and dogs dream, right? Or the little dog is yipping away like it's an exciting thing, like the couch has turned into a mountain of kibble or something, you know? But octopuses dream too. They've measured their brain frequencies. And I've got stories at the yin yang about all these octopus stories, but I'll only tell two. One is that demonstrates kind of the playfulness of an octopus from this book. There was a woman that was giving her doctorate presentation. She was getting ready to do her thesis, her dissertation in front of the, defend her dissertation in front of the board that she was defending in front of. And she had an octopus in a tank beside her, and she was all set to do her presentation, and she was going to get the octopus and take it out. The octopus hid behind a rock, and she couldn't remove her. And then, as she was trying to coax it, it sucked up about the equivalent of 2 gallons of 47 degrees water and sprayed it all over her. So she had to do her presentation soaking wet and freezing cold. The other octopus story speaks to their intelligence and their need for play. Aquariums often have staff members that are dedicated to entertaining the octopuses. And there was one entertainment fail when this one octopus, in the middle of the night, decided to explore this fascinating wheel that was inside her tank. And she turned it, and she played with it, and she turned it some more, and she turned it some more. When the staff came in the next day, the whole bottom floor of the aquarium was flooded because it had been a water faucet. She turned it on, overflowed her tank, got out. The aquarium was flooded, and I'm sure that the octopus was in the corner going, ha, 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 laughing away with her 8 little legs covering her little mouth. They named that octopus Lucretia McEvil. But my thought about us, now this is the part of the talk you may not like, okay? I'm just brace yourselves, okay? You and I, or any of us, may have a Lucretia McEvil in our lives. And I'm going to give us, should you choose to accept the assignment, a small strategy that we can do to help us cope with the Lucretia or Lorenzo McEvils in our lives. This is directed specifically at the notion of asking the question, what is it like to be you? Either silently or out loud, but also in a specific circumstance. When we are butting heads with someone. Now, I rarely butt heads. Now I feel like I'm going to lie in church. I rarely butt heads with people in person, I think. I don't know. You tell me after the service. But in my mind, oh my goodness, I'm probably the only one, right, that has an ongoing argument in my mind about someone who has done me wrong or someone that has said something inappropriate or unkind to me, in my opinion. Ongoing and ongoing and ongoing, arguing and arguing and arguing about how they are wrong and I am correct. There are several thoughts about that. Oh, no, not ready for that slide yet. One of the quotes that I've heard for years around my house from my husband, from George Gurdjieff, right? Argument is insane, right? Argument is insane. There is only the objective exchange of subjective opinions. Yeah, that's a lie. Because when it's my opinion, it's right, right? Right? Same with yours, right? We think our opinion is the truth. And the other quote I was thinking of was Deepak Chopra, who says, when you argue with the way things are, when you argue with reality, you're arguing against the entire universe, past, present, and future, because all kinds of things have assembled to make this moment what it is. So our argument can be fruitless and frustrating. And one of the ways to get out of that cycle is to ask silently, what is it like to be you? The first time I noticed this question, I asked this question, was years and years ago, before I came here. I was just finishing up ministerial school, and I thought I was so holy. But I used to work as a corporate trainer, and it was a rather high-profile job, so I interfaced with a lot of different people, a lot of different departments, and a lot of different personalities. And there was this one guy who was a scientist and an engineer. Sorry, Jennifer, I do not mean to profile engineers. Reverend Jennifer is an engineer. But anyway, he just worked my last nerve to bits. And I'm not going to go into what he was like. Let's just call him Lorenzo McEvil, okay? Lorenzo worked my last nerve to bits. And there was one day when he did something that I thought was particularly obnoxious. So I noticed myself starting the script in my head about how bad Lorenzo was, how I was right and he was wrong, and I should put him in his place. And I was in my office at the time. And because I was in ministerial school and I was trying to be a little more holy, I said, okay, just stop. Just stop. Kind of like you say to a dog, drop it. Drop it. Just drop it. Just stop it. And so I breathed and I meditated. And the question came into my head, the question that is the same title as this talk. What is it like to be you? What is it like to be you, Lorenzo? Now, I did not dial his number and ask him that. I just asked it in my head. And as soon as I opened up that space, the crack in my armor widened a little bit. And I remembered that Lorenzo's parents had both died recently, within 6 months of each other. And he had a sister that had a terminal illness. And he was a young father that was trying to make ends meet, trying to support his young family. And it changed. It changed me. I don't know whether or not it changed Lorenzo, because it didn't matter anymore. Lorenzo was giving me an opportunity to practice a small inner act of kindness, because we lead by inner transformation. He gave me the opportunity to practice, because another Gurdjieff Uspensky quote is, we are here to work on ourselves, only ourselves. And we thank anyone who gives us the opportunity. I still want to do right now. And you may say, okay, that's just a trivial thing. How did that matter? I don't know, but we do trust the ripples in this church. We know that ripples are real. And I have another example of a situation that wasn't so trivial. This is Joel Goldsmith, who is a spiritual teacher. Isn't he cute? I love his little bow tie, don't you? It's so cute. All y'all should wear bow ties like that more often, right? Right, Jim? Yeah? No? Okay. No, okay, never mind. Okay. Anyway, Joel Goldsmith tells a story about a time he was serving in a prison. He was serving as the first reader for a Christian Science service. And he said that the first three times he did it, it was just awful. I imagine Joel Goldsmith, have you ever seen that Monty Python where the monks are praying and then they beat themselves with a board, right? I imagined him holding Mary Baker Eddy's textbook and saying the words and then going, bam, beating himself in the face with it, because he said it was awful, it was horrible, he hated it. And then he had a realization. He realized that the staff in the prison had told him he needed to be on guard. He needed to be on guard for the evil that was likely to come his way. And he decided instead to see the innocence in these people that he was serving. Now, a lot of them had committed crimes. One of them hadn't. But he knew beneath the layers of what he calls the carnal mind and the arm of flesh, he knew that there was a God presence within them. When we sing, I am remembering who I am, we are remembering it for all people. And so he started seeing the innocence within them. And the service got better. It got easier for him. And it went from 12 people to 200 people in attendance. So you see what I mean? The inner work that we can do is powerful. And it's so accessible and so available to us all the time. The question, what is it like to be you, invokes these qualities. It invokes compassion for the other, for the perceived other, because we're really all one. It invokes understanding for the perceived other. It invokes innocence, the willingness to see that that person was once and still is, underneath all of the layers of ego, an innocent child of the divine. It invokes freedom. Freedom from our own bondage, the bondage that we create when we argue in our heads about something. Argument is armor. You like the Tin Woodman there? All the other knights were too scary looking, so I picked him. Argument is armor. It's a way of protecting ourselves, isn't it? You know, when we are arguing about with someone who isn't even there, we're trying to boost up our own self-approval, perhaps. We're trying to make somebody think well of us. We're trying to please God. We're trying to please somebody. We're trying to control the situation. And our argument is an armor for all of that. Armor binds us. Can you imagine how hard it is to move in armor? Has anyone ever worn armor in a play or something? Oh, look at you. It's hard to move, right? You're the Tin Woodman. Great. Yeah, I can imagine it's hard to move in armor. And the armor that we have in our heads binds us as well. And here's a good one. Argument is addiction. Again, I don't know if this applies to any of you, but if you want to, we'll do a show of pinkies as to who might have, just like, keep this anonymous, show your pinky to yourself if you have an addiction. For those of you who are new, we do a show of pinkies when we're embarrassed. Oh, look, David's pinky's up in the air. Hi, David. Okay, good. Yeah, somebody's showing me their whole hand, okay. Yeah. And you know how addiction is? Addiction is just a word I can't say in church. It's just such a pain, because addiction feels so good, doesn't it? It feels good while you're doing it, and then you regret it afterwards. And you realize the consequences are not building the life you hope to build for yourself. You know? I mean, the addictions that I struggle with, I think many of you are familiar with them, is like eating too much sugar, too much Candy Crush, too much television, Netflix, whatever. And, you know, when I want to do it, it feels so good. And then I look back on the day and I'm like, what did you do today? Argument is a similar type of addiction. It feels really good while we're doing it. We feel so righteous, don't we? We feel like we're changing something. We feel like we're proving something. But it's not leading to the long-term effects that we hope for ourselves and the world, that alleviation of suffering that I mentioned at the very beginning. Ernest Holmes, our founder, wrote, "We are bound because we are first free." Meaning that our free will is so free, it has the capacity to bind us. We can make choices that are not good for us. And I would add to that, this is a paradox, a pair of ducks, a paradox, right? It's a good way to remember paradox. I would add to that, discipline offers freedom. That's a shame, right? That's a shame. But you know, you look at a musician has to practice, a musician has to learn the basics, has to practice the basics, and then they have the freedom to be able to express themselves in an exuberant way. I know that when I overeat, I don't have as much freedom when I am eating in a healthy manner. I have much more energy, and I'm much more available for the intervention of spirit, for a download of spirit. Discipline offers freedom. Get over it. Discipline offers freedom. It's the truth, folks. It's the truth. Even if I don't want to believe it, it's the truth. So one discipline that we can practice, it's not too painful, is the discipline of self-awareness. It actually starts to become fun after a while. The discipline of self-awareness. We look at ourselves with the eyes of God. We step back and get the bigger picture. Look at ourselves. Look at our armor with the eyes of God and see what comes up for us. What is that armor about? When I examine my armor, particularly the armor of argument, I see that it has a path that it normally takes. Now, occasionally, I will win the argument in my head. I will be so wise and so pithy that the person will just bow down at my feet and say, "Oh my gosh, you're right. What was I thinking?" That does not happen very often. Usually, when I argue in my head, the person has some equally pithy insight back at me, and then I have to argue about that. And then they have another comment, and then I argue about that. Arguing becomes a vicious cycle, and we can't get out of it unless we do something else. We let go of the argument, and in honor of octopuses, this octopus is holding on with 7 legs and has 1 leg up, and she's saying, "I'm doing it. I'm letting go." We let go. And when we let go, there's a void. So what can we put in that void? How about the practice of allowing? You know, I know I told you all you weren't going to like this talk. I think it's because I don't much like it. I don't want to do any of this stuff, you know? But, okay, just set a good example. The practice of allowing. I often will wake up with Ram Dass talking in my ear in the morning. Now, it's not as psychic as it sounds. I listen to YouTube at night to help me go to sleep, and I usually start with a politically incorrect comic because that's the only thing that I don't want to jump up and take notes on, right? Some of the spiritual stuff that I quote-unquote should listen to, I'm like, oh, that's a great idea. Let me write that down. So I listen to comedians. And then by the morning, because YouTube knows me very well, we're very close friends, I get spiritual input in my queue when it's time to wake up. And the other day, I heard Ram Dass. Now, for those of you who don't know, Ram Dass started out as Richard Alpert. He went to India. He met his guru, Neem Karoli Baba. He was transformed, and he came back to be a great spiritual teacher. He refers to himself as a Hindu, okay? So he combines a lot of faiths. He also talks about Buddhism quite a bit, and he's no longer with us, but he offers a lot of wisdom. Ram Dass suggested that when we allow the other to be, whether it's in our head or in person, that is a positive approach to dealing with that issue of arguing in our heads. As offensive as it feels, it is a positive approach. And the reason it's a positive approach, he said, is because as soon as we start arguing with somebody, whether it's silent or out loud, they immediately start creating defenses to the argument. Even if they don't know that we're saying it, you know, there is one mind here, the one mind of God, and there is some sensation that they have that we are against them, and they start building up a wall against us, against what we have to say. So we let go of the need to argue and listen. Ram Dass also quoted Sai Baba in one of the messages I was listening to. Now, Sai Baba was an Indian mystic who was a manifester. He was one of those folks that could, like, manifest a necklace or whatever in his hand. And, you know, there's several schools of thought about whether or not he was really doing it. But I loved what Ram Dass said about him. Ram Dass said that Sai Baba said this: I give people what they want, so people will want what I give. Now, in terms of Sai Baba, entertains people with a trinket or something, so eventually they can hear the deeper spiritual message, right? In terms of what we're talking about, we give people what we want. When the temptation for argument comes upon us, we give people what they want, which is compassion, listening, understanding, perceiving their innocence, so that eventually, if there really is something that they need to know from us, they will want what we have to offer, because the level of trust will have been built up in a profound and deep way. And we'll also be able to offer it in a kinder way if we have spent time listening and understanding. Again, what do people want? People want compassion. People want understanding. People want innocence, the perception of innocence. And people want freedom. Are we able to offer that to others? And can we start with offering it to ourselves? Because as we do unto others, we do unto ourselves, because there truly is only one of us, right? That thing that I say almost every Sunday, we love our neighbor as we love ourselves. It's not that we love our neighbor as much as we love ourselves. As we love our neighbor, we are loving ourselves, and as we are loving ourselves, we are loving our neighbor. Because there is only one body here. It is the body of spirit, the body of the divine, and we are it. And so is everyone else, and so is everything else. The question comes up, will I be a doormat? Yes, I dressed my guinea pig up like a Mormon missionary. I apologize. I used to dress him up a lot, and that was the only costume he didn't like. I think because his little shirt was a little too tight, or maybe it was the necktie. I don't know, but anyway. Will we be a doormat? That's a fear for some people, particularly people that have been doormats their whole lives and haven't been assertive at all, and can't seem to stand up for their own needs. I'll just tell you my experience with this. When I choose to refrain from manipulating people, whether it's in my head or in person, then I am far less vulnerable to the manipulation of others. When I allow, I am allowed. When I allow people to be who they are, I find that I'm more assertively able to allow myself to be who I am. When I love, I am able to love myself, and I claim the love of the universe. Does that make sense? Good, because I am concerned that people are going to let other people walk on them as a result of this message, and that's not the truth at all. It's not about letting people walk on you. It's about just being centered and grounded in equanimity, in peace, in power, in spiritual power, and say yes when we mean it, and say no when we mean it. You know that our yes is only as strong as our no. In other words, if we say no, then our yes has more meaning. A little more on that, about being a doormat. Compassion is not blind consent to human willfulness. Compassion is a conscious promise to spiritual skillfulness. Remember, it is discipline that sets us free. And so we discipline ourselves to learn and practice and be the spiritual skillfulness that we wish to see in the world. Compassion is not blind consent to human willfulness. Compassion is a conscious promise to spiritual skillfulness. I know that this probably seems, may seem a little foreign to some people. Some people may make sense to, some people it may not make sense to. But I think the part where I get stuck is that it seems so micro to me. You know, there's all this talk nowadays about microaggressions, and I just don't go there. I would much prefer to talk about micro-kindnesses, because micro-kindnesses get the job done. We hold the intention of goodwill. We do small acts of kindness, micro-kindnesses, and then we detach from the results and trust the ripples, because ripples are real. So I'm going to ask you this morning, what is it like to be you? And I invite you to read this phrase with me and really mean it. Really mean the spiritual truth about ourselves. And here we go. I am compassionate. I am strong. I am free. I am skillful. I am willing to be the change I wish to see. And so it is. Let us pray. Thank you. Okay. And so we turn within, trusting and knowing the divine source, the one life that is God's life, that is the life of love, that is higher power, spirit, blessed one, the living one, whatever it is we choose to call it. It is the energy that infuses this universe, that fills us, that lives and moves and has its being through us, but also is in the stars and the sun and the octopuses and the sea, the sand, the trees, the flowers, the bees, everything. Everything is this life that is God. And so we participate in that. We cannot help but participate in it, because it is the life of who we are, this energy of spirit. And so today I consciously align with that life, and I know it as my life. And as I speak these words for myself, I speak them for everyone here, that we truly are the life of love, the life of the oneness that is. And so from this place, I know that we have taken in what we need to hear from this message, from this music, from this fellowship, from this community. And we allow it to percolate within us, to bring us to new levels of understanding of our place in the world and our place of alleviating suffering for ourselves and for others. Together we practice the intention of goodwill, the spirit and the action of loving kindness, small acts of kindness. And we renounce the fruits. We renounce the fruits, as it says in the Bhagavad Gita. We renounce the fruits and allow the ripples to happen in their own way, because ripples are real. I trust that every single person here finds unique ways suited to them, suited to their divine calling, to practice these principles. And I know that the world is blessed because of all of us. And so with a grateful heart, I just say thank you. Thank you so much for this time together. Thank you for love. Thank you for spirit. Thank you for this teaching. Thank you for transformation. I bless all paths to God, churches, synagogues, temples, mosques, ashrams, all paths. For all paths are a blessing in their own unique way. And with a heart filled with gratitude, I say thank you, spirit. Thank you, love. And I release these words into the divine mystery. And together we say, and so it is. Hi.
Hi, Bonnie.
Lonnie, our board president.
Well, everybody stayed.
Yeah, they did.
Okay. It's a loving place to hear things that are important.
Okay, thank you.
And I love the thread of compassion from Dion. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that made me remember is a class you taught about boundaries.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
how boundaries are loving kindness mm-hmm. in action. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it really feels like that's an important piece
yes.
to compassion and courage mm-hmm. and being that change mm-hmm. that you wish to see in the world. It's mm-hmm. not always easy mm-hmm. of that. And I'm kind of stalling a bit. Because the words
oh,
haven't come up for them.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Brian. If you're not home, the message for, or the words for the offering are being projected, and I can't remember them. I mean, okay. how many, 15 years?
Yeah,
no,
sorry.
That's not going to happen. So in that space of loving kindness for ourselves and others, I invite you to place your offering over your heart and repeat after me. We trust in spirit.
We trust in spirit.
Love is the giver and receiver of all that we are.
Love is the giver and receiver of all that we are.
We offer this gift.
We offer this gift.
It is an outer expression of our inner abundance and compassion.
It is an outer expression of our inner abundance and compassion.
Our gifts bless many.
Our gifts bless many.
And return to us multiplied in miraculous ways.
And return to us multiplied in miraculous ways.
So that we may give again.
So that we may give again.
And so it is.
And so it is. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bonnie, for a wonderful talk, as always. Always. We had a, I had selected a song that, again, tied in beautifully with Bonnie's message, but I tell you, in that space of gratitude, and as I left Los Angeles in torrential rains and saw that things were passing and the sky was opening up in a different kind of a way once I got to Calabasas, I was inspired. Please indulge me to just gift you with this song that we all know and love. Over the Rainbow. When all the world is a hopeless jumble and the raindrops tumble all around, heaven opens a magic lane. When all the clouds darken up the skyway, there's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from your window pane to a place behind the sun, just a step beyond the rain. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue, and the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops way above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find me. The rainbow,
birds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, why can't I? Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops way above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find me, somewhere over the rainbow. Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I? If happy little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow, why, oh, why can't I?
Thank you, Chris.
I think I'm a puddle. I'll invite all of the practitioners and ministers that are going to do 1 minute miracles to join me down here. So while we're doing our closing affirmation. All of you, all y'all, come on down. So this reminds me to remind you that if you would like prayer with a practitioner to anchor into the message of today, or to celebrate something, or to work through something, find that boundary, find that compassion. These are our practitioners, and they will help you with that. So I'm going to take a deep breath in, and I invite everybody to, we're going to say, read the closing affirmation together. We are love. We share love. We serve love. In every part of our lives, thank you for our lives. And so it is. So it is. Namaste, everyone.